Welcome back to Turning Hard Times and Good Times. I'm your host, Jay Taylor, and I'm really pleased to have with me once again Nolan Watson. Nolan is the co-founder of Sandstorm Gold. That occurred in 2008. Previous to that, he had served as the CFO of Silver Wheaton Corp., now known as Wheaton Precious Metals Corp. He and his team have built Sandstorm up to the point where the company's shareholders, I believe, will start to enjoy some rapid growth in earnings and cash flow, especially a couple of years out from now. Sandstorm is a streaming royalty company. Compared to its peers, it is selling at a considerable discount. That fact, plus some other very important positive factors, makes the stock especially attractive at its current price of around $3.80 in U.S. funds. There are approximately 184 million shares outstanding, which, as Nolan pointed out the last time we spoke to him, the number of shares have actually decreased by about 5 million thanks to a buyback program that the company has been engaged in, believing, as management does, that this company is very undervalued. And so I'm really pleased to have Nolan back with me. Thanks for joining me again, Nolan.
Well, thanks for having me, Jay.
It's really good to catch up with you because I think this is really truly a story that is not appreciated as much as it should be. Should mention that Sandstorm trades in the New York Exchange under symbol SAND, SAND, and in Toronto, SSL. Nolan, when you were last with me, that was September 13th, you explained why streaming and royalty companies bring with them less risk than operating companies, and you also explained some of the longer-term advantages that Sandstorm has over some of its better-known peers. Now, for the sake of those that may not have heard our last discussion, could you perhaps briefly go over some of those ideas?
Yeah, so the whole reason for the business model, the reason that Sandstorm exists, is to try to deliver higher return, lower risk investments to investors. The mining industry is fraught with risk, and so royalty companies, we take a lot of those risks out by A, diversifying. So instead of investing in one mine or two mines, when you invest in a company at Sandstorm, we have 188 streams and royalties around the world. So you get the diversification of different mines, different partners, different countries, and that acts as a portfolio and stabilizes those investment returns over the longer term. It's just a lot more stable way to invest. We also don't have a lot of the risks that mining companies do. So risks that operating costs are going to go high. Sometimes if you invest in a mining company where it costs them $1,000 to operate their mine on an all-in sustaining cost basis, if gold were to go from $1,200 to $1,000, they're not making any money anymore and your returns go to zero. Whereas at a streaming and royalty company, we get X percentage of the revenue, so we're still making significant positive cash flow at all times from around the world. And even during hard times, we can use that cash flow to buy assets on the cheap and profit from those when commodity prices go up. There are hundreds of other reasons to invest in royalty companies over mining companies and the safety it gives. One is exploration upside. We get all the exploration upside mining companies do, but we don't have to pay for it. The mining companies pay for the exploration, which for Sandstorm is significant. One of the things you had mentioned was we have advantages over some of our other royalty peers, and one of those is the average property size underneath our royalties is dramatically higher than the royalties at a lot of our competitors. We have several of our largest royalties with hundreds or thousands of square kilometers per royalty area. And that's one of the reasons why for every dollar invested in Sandstorm, the amount of meters drilled is double the next highest royalty company in the world from an exploration perspective, and about four or five times higher for every dollar invested than some of the big royalty companies in the world. So there are a lot of reasons to own a royalty company, and within the royalty space there are a lot of reasons to own Sandstorm.
Yeah, it would seem so, and I know that you explained the last time before you go out and get involved in a project, one of the things you want to see that a lot of your peers don't seem to pay as much attention to is what are the exploration upside? What is the exploration upside of the potential to grow your company that way with the other companies spending? I guess you probably try to get these get your deals structured so that you have as much of this potential upside as possible. In our last discussion, you referred to the growth profile that you're really talking about kicking up the number of ounces that you expect, the gold equivalent ounces that you expect, to something like 140,000 by 2023, and that compares to 60,000 ounces or thereabouts this year, I think, is what you have projected. Can you explain once again, perhaps for the benefit of people that didn't hear our discussion last time, what are a couple of the key projects that are causing that growth in 2022 and 2023?
Yeah, so over the next 3 years, we anticipate, as you said, that our production is going to go up dramatically. So next year, we should cash flow around $60 million U.S., but that's going to double over a three-year period based on solely the assets that we have already purchased. So Sandstorm has more growth built into its royalty portfolio than any of the other streaming royalty companies in the world right now. And there are a number of mines coming online, but the three big contributors to that, number one would be Hod Maden. That's an asset that is fast-tracking towards production. We expect it to be up and running in 2022, so only 3 years from now. And then the other two would be Cerro Moro, which is a Yamana mine in Argentina. And then there's a third one, which is Aurizona, which is being built by Equinox right now. Equinox and their Arizona project is, they just put out a press release saying it's 80% constructed already. And so that should be up and running and producing gold by Q1 2019, so just a few months away. We should be getting royalty checks from it by Q2 2019. Cerro Moro, which is an even bigger project for us. In fact, Cerro Moro is, to date, other than Hod Maden, is the largest streaming deal that we've ever done. And when it comes online next year for us, it'll be the biggest stream to ever have come online in the history of Sandstorm. And that mine, we just got notice from Yamana that it is fully constructed and they've met the conditions for commercial production under our contract, and therefore officially on January 1st, so coming up here in a couple months, that stream kicks in for Sandstorm as well.
Wow, that's really good news. Anything on Hod Maden since we last spoke back in September 13th?
Yeah, that project is moving forward very quickly. I've recently received notice that if people actually look in our investor presentation, they'll notice that we say construction is anticipated to begin towards the end of 2020. And just recently got notice that a lot of the early works, collaring portals for the decline into the underground mine, tunneling and that type of stuff, they're actually looking at bringing it forward a year and doing it this upcoming year towards the end of the year, which is fantastic, de-risking the timeline and schedule towards production. I'll be very excited when that mine is in construction because it is the coolest undeveloped gold mine in the entire world.
Yeah, the costs of production to be something less than $400 U.S., I guess?
Yeah, all in sustaining costs on a co-product basis are expected to be less than
So what sort of levels of production are anticipated or projected from Hod Maden?
Yeah, so we have a 30% net profits interest in that contract.
Right. Uh-huh.
So we have a very significant vested interest in that. And the level of production is expected to be about 260,000 gold equivalent ounces per year right out of the gate. Some of the highest grades are, you know, it's already 11-year mine life and growing, but you hit the right grades right at the beginning. And so it's a huge amount of gold coming right as soon as the mine turns on.
You had a news release that came out on the 9th of October listing a lot of the various projects and the progress of those projects. And the Diviak Diamond Mine, now of course you're known for your gold and silver royalty and streaming projects, but what caused the company to get involved with this project and how significant is it in terms of earnings and cash flow?
Yeah, right now it ranges from probably 8 to 10% of our current cash flow. For those of you who aren't familiar with the Diavik mine, it produces a very significant percentage of the world's diamonds. It produces millions of carats per year. We have a 1% royalty on it. It's one of the lower cost diamond mines in the world. It's operated by Rio Tinto. And they're mining from a few different pipes. And the significance there is the A21 pipe, which is their most recent pipe, just came online and just completed construction, and they're starting to mine that now, and so we're receiving royalty checks from that as well.
Just a question about how you determine when and at what price you sell gold. You made an announcement recently that you sold 14,450 ounces of gold in Q3. So does management have a policy in terms of its sales of gold? Because, if I were managing the company, I'd probably be tempted to speculate. But you have to keep your shareholders in mind, and obviously, I just wondered what sort of policy you have with regard to when you sell your gold.
Yeah, we have a lot of things that we speculate on. Obviously, one is the value of royalties. But right now, We think that although gold is undervalued, we think that our shares are even more undervalued. So typically what we do is as soon as we get a shipment of gold, we sell it right away, irrespective of the price. And with some of our surplus cash flow, we're going into the market and buying back our own shares with that, so that when we do that, and our investors are inherently then getting more exposure to gold for a share they own when we do that. We've, as you mentioned at the beginning, purchased a number of shares over the last year. It's my expectation that we will, all things being equal, purchasing even more shares next year. Buying back a lot of shares is something that is top of mind and one of our top priorities at Sandstorm right now.
I'd like to get back to your October 9th press release, because there seems to be some really exciting things taking place there. One of the things that really caught my eye was a headline number from the Black Fox project that McEwen Mining is mining, 53.9 grams per ton over 8.23 meters. What can you tell us about the upside, or the potential upside, from Black Fox for Sandstorm?
Yeah, so Black Fox is continuing to deliver fantastic drilling results. We've got some information in that press release, as you said, as well as some past press releases. I'm being told that Rob McEwen is comparing this to Red Lake in the early days, and they've been saying that in their investor days. There's a reason why they drilled 100,000 meters or approximately around that this year, and it's just a very exciting project. One of the interesting things about the Black Fox stream that we have is we paid just over $50 million for that stream, and we've gotten over $60 million back already. So we've made all of our money, plus a return, and now they're still drilling it, you know, 100,000 meters a year for future exploration upside. So it's just turned into a great investment for us.
I guess that's a good example of why royalty companies, and why your decision to go out and invest in companies that have a lot of upside really is very, very special. In your October 10th, on your October 9th release, you also announced that Sandstorm had purchased 1.19 million shares of Entree Resources at a price ranging between Canadian 44 cents and 55 cents. Stock is currently trading today, I noticed, at about 52 cents. What is your interest, and why are you, what does Entree Resources have to offer, and why are you buying, taking an equity interest in that company?
Yeah, so what Entree owns is a passive 20% interest in the profit of a portion of the Turquoise Hill mine in Mongolia, which is one of the world's best copper mines. It's a long-dated asset in the sense that Rio Tinto is not going to be mining on that ground for probably another several years, call it 6-7 years, so it's a ways out. We think it's a logical takeover target by Rio Tinto. And we did a stream on that asset a number of years ago. I think it was 2013 when we did that stream. And we bought a very significant equity stake in Entree at the time we did the stream in 2013. And so we just want to make sure that we own and control enough shares that if Rio Tinto or someone does come knocking to take them out, that we can make sure that they pay a fair and reasonable price. So we're trying to keep the share structure tight and be a key decision maker in that process, and making sure that they pay the right number.
Wow, very good. So just a couple of other things. You have a project called the Ming Mine that you have an interest in. Can you talk about that? Eastern Canada.
Yeah, it's a high-grade copper mine with some gold in Eastern Canada, and we have the right to buy about 30% of the gold. We did that deal back in, I want to say, 2010. They got the mine running in 2011-12, and so we've been purchasing gold ever since, and they continue to have great exploration success. The mine looks like it has a multi-decade mine life ahead of it, and so we're glad to have that one in our portfolio as well. It's one of the great things about our portfolio is that we have 187 streams and royalties, and so we're constantly putting up these updates like the October 9th one. There's a whole bunch of stuff that didn't even make the cutoff for the press release, or our press releases would be 40 pages long. But there's just always stuff happening in the portfolio, and it's good to see.
No question about it. When might you be coming out with your Q3 earnings? Would that be coming out pretty soon?
Yeah, the target date for that is mid-November. I think it's either the 14th or the 15th that we should be putting out results.
Very good. And so I suppose You and your geologists that you have on staff there are continuing to look for new opportunities. That's something that, as long as the gold market remains relatively weak, I suppose there's still opportunities out there?
Yeah, we're always looking for things. We're currently doing due diligence on a number of things. One of the challenges that we're having is that one of the most attractive assets we think we can buy right now is our shares. So we're trying to allocate capital, and the way I'm thinking about it right now is that we want to use most of our cash flow from operations to buy back our shares. We don't want to go out and borrow money to buy back our shares. We think that's a bit risky.
Yes.
Because the borrowing doesn't come with increased cash flowing capacity when you buy back your own shares.
Mm-hmm.
But then what we're doing is we're evaluating potential future deals against, does it make sense to do this, to borrow money to do this deal? And so we're looking at upsizing our revolving debt facility. We're totally debt-free right now. We have absolutely no debt. But we do have a revolving debt facility that if we find something really exciting that's going to be cash flowing now or cash flowing within a year or so, we might temporarily draw down on that debt facility to make that acquisition. We just don't ever want to have to issue shares for an acquisition.
Yeah, I think the last time we spoke, you mentioned that your line of credit is something like $150 million. You could get more if you needed it, if you wanted it. And your cash position, more or less, in the company now?
Yeah, so right now we have $20 million in cash approximately, but we also have $55 million of debt and equity investments in other mining companies.
Anything else, Nolan, before we wrap it up today?
No, very briefly, I think one of the other things in that press release on October 9th was Equinox Gold, so their Arizona project. They just started drilling an area called Tatajuba, and we think that could double the size of the mine. We should be getting $5 or $6 million of cash flow per year, royalty cash flow from them starting next year. So whenever you can double the mine life, that's a pretty exciting thing. And so I would encourage people and prospective investors to keep watching that story as well.
Well, it is an exciting story that you have, Nolan. No question about it. And I think from a risk reward perspective, especially now when people aren't terribly excited about mining stocks, Sandstorm makes an awful lot of sense. I think for people that don't want to have to be bothered keeping on top of mining projects, you let your guys do that job for the investors, and obviously professionals that you have on your staff know what they're doing. So I really thank you for taking the time to talk to us today, Nolan, and look to do it again sometime, I hope.
Well, thanks very much. We appreciate it.
All right.